Well, first of all, I thank the organizer for this opportunity. And we have all been learning how complex is the concept of the habitable zone. It's a multidimensional concept. And it brings together theoreticians and experimental people and observational people to a common framework. It provides a kind of common language, a lingua franca for astrobiology. And the goal of my talk is to discuss one of these dimensions, one of the many dimensions of the concept of the habitable zone, which are the high energy emissions in low mass stars, their time scales, and their relevance for habitability, the limitations they impose on habitability. And we have a crew of people working on this, an international team, actually. So it's a common feature of low mass stars, which are the stars with relevant time scales for astrobiology, the ones that live the longest, that they have surface convection, and this convection ties the plasma to differential rotation, and that creates the concentration and the creation of the magnetic fields. So all of these stars, they show magnetic activity. It's a way to convert mechanical rotational energy into magnetic energy, and this is in its turn converted to radiative and particle fluxes. So we can study the sun in great detail, and we watch the magnetized regions in the surface as they grow and then fade away, and there is also flares, transient phenomena, and also winds, the ejection of high energy particles, high velocity particles, and all of these phenomena is common to low mass stars. And so we have high energy photons and high energy particles participating in the evolution of the star. And this is a common feature of all low mass stars, starting from about 1.5 solar masses downwards to the very lowest mass stars. And planetary evolution, even the Earth, is at least in part governed by these high energy stellar emissions, because the star is the overwhelmingly large source of energy. And we have many relevant time scales, many relevant modulations, from days and hours in transient phenomena like flares and the rotation and the appearance of active regions, to cycles like the solar sunspot cycle in tens to hundreds of years. And the one more relevant to our discussion, those time scales related to hundreds of millions and billions of years, related to the spin down of the star. So as the angular momentum is carried away from the star by winds, the star spins down and all the level of activity tends to diminish exponentially. So stellar radiation, the presence of this high energy component, it governs the thermal structure and the very existence of planetary atmospheres in a very critical way. Models have difficulty reproducing this high energy regime because it is strongly non-thermal. It does not arise from the fact that the star has a given temperature. It's a magnetic component that evolves very strongly with time. And this is quite important for the presence and the evolution of planetary atmospheres. So what we observe in the sun is but a snapshot, because we know that these emissions evolve. So what we really need to, in order to trace a timeline for the evolution of these low mass stars, is a bunch of nearby stars for which we can measure fluxes with good precision, and also in a narrow mass and chemical composition regime so that they have the same rotational and convection properties. This has been the pioneering work of Manuel Gudel. He's sitting right over there. And so we can trace a timeline for these emissions, and it turns out to be extremely exponential. So as we watch young stars and old stars, rotation diminishes with age, and so does magnetic activity. Actually, this is the solar twin, 18 scope. It's very similar to the sun, same age, same chemical composition, same luminosity, and same mass, and does have the same properties, even a very similar sunspot cycle. So as we consider stars in different rotational regimes and different ages, this is a kind of cartoon of what we observe. So the sun rotated much faster when it was young, and the magnetic activity was much enhanced. And these snapshots allow us to observe stars with different ages and how the density and the presence and the strength of magnetic regions evolve with time, and also the winds. And so this magnetic activity provides the non-thermal component of high energy radiation, especially the X-rays and the extreme UV regime. And we can see that the younger stars from top to bottom, young stars and older stars, how this component it does not evolve too much in the thermal UV and the visible, but it does evolve a lot in the X-rays and the extreme UV, up to many orders of magnitudes, so that we learn that the very young sun was actually 1,000 times brighter in the X-ray, to from 10 to 100 times brighter in the extreme and the far UV, and a few times brighter in the UV. So this evolution, it does present an important background for planetary atmospheric evolution. And also coupled to these high energy emissions, like the X-ray, we actually observe a very good correlation between the X-ray fluxes here and the mass loss, the loss of high velocity particles. And this star have corona. Corona is essentially the atmosphere evaporating. And so these open magnetic flux tubes, they're actually like hoses trained upon the planets, emitting high energy and high velocity particles. And it does evolve very quickly with time, exponentially at first. And actually, there's an interesting side note to this, because if we consider the upper limit of what the sun was supposed to be doing, as it was zero AZ stars, the mass loss rate was about 1,000 to 10,000 times larger than what we observe today in the present sun here. And so it actually may provide a solution for one of the oldest conundrums in astrobiology, which is the faint young sun. The Earth was not supposed to be habitable, as the sun, when it was very young, was much less luminous. But it has been losing mass at these rates. We can infer that it could have been slightly more massive stars at zero age, a few percent more massive. And this alone may suffice to put the sun in a brighter state and perhaps explain the early Earth, Mars and Earth evolution, because you wouldn't need actually to provide more greenhouse gases like methane and carbon dioxide to explain the observed habitability of the Earth. This is an interesting side note to the mass loss question. So what's the effect of this on planets? It's actually a tiny amount of the total power. Even for the very young sun, the amount was quite small, and for the present sun, it's even smaller. So why worry with this? The question is that these photons, the high energy photons, they are heavyweights. They carry a lot of punch, and they are injected onto the low density upper atmosphere. They are thermalized there in high altitudes. And it's not just a question of sheer power. The actual process matter. And so they are really heavyweight. So these particle winds, they can erode the atmosphere. They can ionize molecules in the atmosphere and then carry them away. Also the X-rays and the extreme UV, they expand the atmosphere. So it actually more of the atmosphere lies beyond the protection of the magnetic field. And in some cases, it can even pop out of the magnetic field and become an obstacle. And then it becomes to be eroded away by the solar wind. So you need the planetary magnetic field to protect you from these effects. And so we have the case of Venus and Mars. Mars, actually, it suffers a lot, has suffered a lot from this effect, because it's a small planet, it does not presently have a magnetic field, so it has suffered intense erosion of the atmosphere. It probably had surface water in the past by the presence of greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide and methane, so the temperature at the surface was probably conducive to the presence of liquid water. But it's a small planet, it suffers erosion from impacts, its core solidifies, it loses the magnetic field, and erosion of the atmosphere wins the upper hand. So calculations suggest that you can lose a total global Martian ocean good to 10 meters depth, perhaps, in a few giga years. Also, the UV photos, they ionize and they oxidize the surface down to a few meters. So Mars has suffered a lot from these effects. Mars actually did not stand a chance in the presence of these effects. Even Venus, which is a much more massive planet, may have lost an equivalent Earth ocean or perhaps somewhat less than this in the time scale of its relevant evolution as submitted to these kind of processes. So we may have had actually three habitable planets in the beginning of the life of the solar system, but now we have only one. And there's a special effect concerning the very lowest mass stars, the red dwarfs, because they keep this high energy state for much longer than the solar type stars like the G and the K type stars. So for a star like the Sun, this state lasts no more than 100 million years, perhaps less. But for the low-mass M-dwarf stars, it takes much, much longer to reduce these levels of activity to bearable levels. This line is 100 times the X-ray luminosity as related to total output as the present sun. So for low-mass stars, if we think that they scale similarly to solar-type stars, planets are submitted in the K-stars to a few times more X-ray and extreme UV photons, and in the case of the M-dwarf stars, up to 100 more times exposure to X-rays as the planets evolve. So we are going to study one of the two case studies that I would like to present. The first one is a famous one, because it's Proxima Centauri, it's the nearest star to our own solar system, and there has been a recent planet, an Earth-like planet discovered in the star. This is the star's true scale to the sun. So it's very low luminosity, it's very low mass, and data suggests that it's about the same age as the sun. And an Earth-like planet in the habitable zone actually receiving about 65% of the radiation that the Earth receives today from the sun has been found in this star. So what's the issue? Its habitable zone is, of course, much closer, and so the planet is exposed to much larger X-ray and extreme UV fluxes and winds, and this phase is also much more extended than the case of the Earth. Another caveat of these stars is that they take much longer to settle down to the stable hydrogen burning phase in the so-called main sequence. So the sun actually took no longer than about 10 million years to achieve this state, but not so for the very low mass stars. They take hundreds of millions to up to 1 giga year settling down to a stable luminosity. So actually this planet was formed outside the habitable zone. It may lie into the habitable zone today, but it was actually formed outside of the zone because of this very slow evolution of luminosity. And this makes for a very high rate of volatile loss from XUV, extreme UV, X-rays, and winds. Of course, we don't know the initial water inventory of this planet. This is one of the biggest uncertainties in this kind of modeling. It could well have been much larger than Earth's, but as we consider the total exposures for the similar ages of the system and our own solar system, this planet has been subjected to up to 10 times higher X-ray and extreme UV photons and up to 100 times higher particle flux. And also the X-ray spectrum is much harder because it's more concentrated in the higher energy tail of the distribution. So it may have happened so that the volatile loss was up to from 1 to 20 Earth ocean equivalents. So if this planet was formed with a much larger volatile inventory than the Earth, even so, it may have lost most or even all of this volatile inventory in the course of its evolution. Of course, we don't know, we really actually don't know the total volatile content, and does depend critically on the magnetic properties and also on the stellar wind evolution, which we do not know in detail. It has even been proposed that the best bet to have an habitable planet in the habitable zone of a red dwarf star, is to have initially a super Earth and then to cook it with high energy emissions so that it loses atmosphere and may eventually become more Earth-like in its composition. So it must have a lot of volatile to survive this extended phase of high energy emissions in the red dwarf stars. And our second and last case study is the case of Kappa Seti, which we met before as we considered the timeline for solar type emissions and time scales. Kappa Seti is a nearby bright star, it's a well-studied star, and it's considered to be an almost perfect analog of the Sun when life was arising on Earth and Venus and Mars were losing their bodies of surface waters. So it's a young star, around 700 million years of age, slightly more massive than the Sun, and this is the spectrum of its energy. So in the extreme UV and the far UV, it's up to a few tens of times more than the present Sun. And in the UV flux, it's about twice as much, and the emissions, they become equal at around 1700 angstroms. And in the thermal UV and the visible, the star actually emits less than the sun, because it's slightly cooler, because it's an early evolution star, and the sun will evolve in terms of increasing its surface temperature. So, and also the wind is up to 100 times the wind of the present sun. It certainly has been relevant to the evolution of Mars. So what possible effects on the atmosphere of the Earth could these high energy emissions have presented? Well, we know that most of the cross sections for absorption for important molecules in the composition of the probable Archean atmosphere of the Earth, like carbon dioxide and water vapor and methane, these cross sections lie in the far UV. So as we consider the Sun without its excess emissions and capacity, which is considered to be an analog for them, we have for the mildly reduced and early atmosphere much higher photodissociation rates, and this could be driving interesting prebiotic pre-organic chemistry. It has even been proposed that one pathway for the formation of ribonucleotides, pyrimidines, basis for DNA, for the genetic code, might lie in using far UV photons to produce the early and initial chemical steps that are difficult to achieve in the surface of the Earth. And this is my last slide. We try to consider in the context of panspermia what the emissions of a very young sun could have presented as a challenge in the transfer of microorganisms between Mars and the Earth. So we consider the higher emissions of capacity in the beamline in the Brazilian synchrotron laboratory, and we assume that a meteorite was carrying microorganisms protected by a supersaline halite crystal, brines, and these crystals, they do occur in the surface of Mars and the Earth. So we tested radio-resistance microbes and also halophilic archaea, age volcani, and the model for the panspermia was the Nakhla Martian meteorites. So we tried to produce a total fluence approximating what a meteorite would suffer in a 100,000-year crossing time. Actually, the survival after a fluence much lower than the one which this crossing time would entail was sufficient to eventually guarantee that no organism survived. So in order to transfer organisms between the Earth and Mars and so forth, you need a very strong protection inside meteorites. Otherwise, this high radiation emission will probably kill all organisms trying to make the crossing. So I guess I'm done. I will leave you with my highlights, and I will be happy to take any questions. Thank you very much.